there is no need to demonstrate that spatial organization of archaeological remains is a key to understand human behavior, whatever the period. Now, most and most complex methodology allow us to describe the spatial distribution of human activity area easily. But with spatial organization, we can go further. We can describe the relationship between those activity area, so between the different human behaviors. And in that way, we can precise the site function, and finally, its place in the management of a territory. But with great methodology comes great responsibility. If we want to propose hypotheses about the management of a territory, we have to choose the best methodology with the proper perimeters in order to well describe human activity area in the living space. So today I will present a new spatial analysis protocol in order to describe the spatial organization of human activity and the relationship between them. In order to develop our methodology, we will focus on the openness site from Middle Paleolithic in northern France. So, northern France is a key region about climatic changes. Neanderthal has to face a great variability of biotope and respond to that with a high mobility. So, we have numerous sites on an extensive territory. And this makes it difficult to be at regional scale. But thanks to Jean-Luc Loche and his team, we have now an excellent chronostratigraphic framework with numerous occupations on an extensive time scale. Most of these sites are openness sites, and for some of them, thanks to quick and thin sedimentation, we have an exceptional preservation in terms of superficie and quantity of archaeological remains. All the pictures of this slide are taken from the site of Kaou, and we will focus our presentation of this site and the site of Beauvais. These two sites have an even better preservation because of calcareous sedimentation. So we have a high quantity of faunal remains that is well preserved, which is very rare for Middle Paleolithic. Here you can see a little cut mark left by Neanderthal 120,000 years ago. So, as you all know, just after the excavation of a Middle Paleolithic site, we have this kind of map. So, with dot cloud, which represent archaeological remains. Here is the fauna of the level 4 of Kaou. First element of spatial analysis that we can observe here is concentration zone of archaeological remains. But how many can you see on this map? 1, 2, 3, more or less, the visual approach is not enough. So we choose to use a methodology based on modelization and GIS in order to describe the concentration zone, their number, and their distribution. And in a second time, we will ask if these concentration zones are actually human activity area. So, before this spatial analysis, we have several questions to ask. First, what kind of spatial data do we want to use? For my study, we will use the dot plot that we see before, but we have a problem of fragmentation of material. On the excavation, we cannot record every smallest remain. So, in this case, we choose to keep it, but for the smaller one, we put it at the center of a meter squared. Now, just some more precision about the archaeozoological framework. If we want to precise what step of botany process we have on the occupation level, we can classify the archaeological remains in two different ways. First, the anatomical part, like you can see with the square, the color square. For example, if you have a concentration zone with only limbs bones, we can know that desarticulation steps are already done and it may be a concentration zone where we take off the meat from the bones. Secondly, we can classify the faunal remains in food utility. So with the grayscale Bond's grayscale. For example, if you have a concentration zone with only low food utility, it may be a wasted zone. Now, just before the spatial analysis, some more precision about Kaur and Bové. Kaur is one of the only Neanderthal occupation from the last integration period in the northwestern Europe. We have four archaeological levels in situ, excavated on 680 meters squared. The three main species are red deer, roe deer, and aurochs. And this fauna is associated with lithic artifacts from discrete mapping and almost non-retouched too. For this presentation, we will focus on the level 4, which is the only level with a high quantity of burn bones. The site of Bové is a Neanderthal occupation for the last glacial period. We have two archaeological levels in situ, excavated on 760 meters squared, and the main species is the reindeer, associated with lithic artifacts from discrete tapping, but this time with some retouch tool. And we will focus on the level 2. Now, let's begin the spatial analysis. This is one of the most common methodology used in archaeology. It's the mesh analysis. It's a simple count of artifact by mesh. Here is the result for the fauna of the level 4 of Kaur. We can observe two main concentration zones here and here. But this methodology has some limitations that make it subjective. For example, the choice of the mesh analysis is always arbitrary. So we choose to replace it by two other methods which are complementary. The first one, you may know it, it's the canal density estimation, or ETMA. It's a modelization method. We calculate in each point of space the density, depending on the number of archaeological remains present in a circle with defined radius. And the result of this methodology is a series of distribution models of concentration zone with the density of this zone. But the research radius here has to be fixed by the analyst. If it's too big, we have an only concentration zone for all the archaeological level, and if it's too small, we have a concentration zone by archaeological remain. So in order to have a reproducible methodology, we have to fix this radius. And for our study, we choose to fix it with another methodology, which is Kamin clustering. It's an analysis methodology. We classify the archaeological remain into a statistically ideal number of groups, depending on the distance between artifacts inside the group. We have to minimize this distance. And the result of this methodology is a number of concentration zones or a number of clusters. And this number will help us to choose a proper radius for the canal density estimation model. So we will apply this methodology to Kaur and Bové. This is the result for the fauna of the level 4 of Kaur. The dot cloud represents the result of the canal density estimation, Kamin clustering, sorry, and the canal density estimation model corresponding to the color grad scale here, from green to red. We still see the two main concentration zones that we see with the mesh analysis. But with this methodology, we were able to define five more concentration zones that we cannot see before. So, are these concentration zones actually human activity area? We apply a methodology to burned bones in red and fractured bones in blue. And we can see that the most important concentration of faunal remains that we see since the beginning is actually a concentration of burned bones, so small and numerous. And the other concentration zone corresponds to fractured bones. So this is actually human activity area. Now can we precise which it is? This is the same map, but with the faunal remains classified by food utility. We can see that the remain with the most important food utility are concentrated around the concentration zone of fractured bones. So it suggests that it's actually a butchery activity area, and they are closely linked to a combustion zone. Now, what can we say about lithic artifacts? With our methodology, we were about to define two main concentration zones of lithic artifacts, one closely linked to the combustion zone with an important quantity of bone lithic artifacts, and one linked with the butchery activity zone just at the east of the first one. This lithic concentration are composed by several different lithic artifacts, like Pointe Levallois nucleus and cortical flex. This suggests that it's actually knapping workshop. Now we have human activity distributed in the living space. Can we precise the relationship between them? Lithic refitting can help us. First, that can help us to better define knapping area, in some cases, like in the level 2 of Beauvais, where a too high quantity of lithic artifact disturbs the signal. For example, here we have a high rate of lithic refitting, which corresponds to the most important quantity of lithic artifact. This suggests that it is actually knapping workshop. Now we still with lithic refitting, but with the burn funnel remain in red and fractured funnel remain in blue. And this time, lithic artifact suggests links between the clapping workshop and the butchery activity area. So this may confirm that the butchery activity process were processed with lithic artifact craft in the clapping area that we previously defined. So, with these two analyses, the Kamin clustering and the canal density estimation, we were able to highlight human activity area, particularly butchery and knapping activity area, closely linked to a combustion zone. And the lithic refitting are helping us to suggest link between those activities. So, in that way, we can propose a complex organization of the living space of Neanderthal in the site of Kao in the site of Beauvais. Thanks for your attention.